What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Daily here from Nation Fusion, and today the Codec returns after being on hiatus for over a year. We thank you guys for joining us today, and we're coming back with an awesome dual interview for you. We've got Stephanie Houston. How you doing?
Hi, I'm doing good. Great, thank you.
Thank you for returning. And one of the most kind of fan favorite interviews we've ever had, Donna Burke and her cat.
Yeah.
this is the scoop. We've got some information on the cat that we're going to share with you guys today. Donna, thank you for taking time to join us. We know it's late there.
Well, actually, thank you, Archie.
Yeah. It wouldn't be possible without Archie. So, Archie, thank you.
Sponsored by Archie.
Right? Yeah. And as you can see, we've got returning co-host Yong Yao. Welcome.
It is so good to be back. It's amazing to see you guys all again. Kept you waiting, huh? That kind of thing.
Stephanie's line, Yong.
What is
Stephanie.
That?
Stephanie.
I thought Stephanie. That was Stephanie's line. Let's just start the whole interview.
Breaking the script, man. Well,
no, but it's amazing to be back. Can't wait for this interview and catch up with everyone.
It has been a few years, right?
Yeah, years. It's kind of crazy.
It's been a few years since we've done an interview with each of you, and it's been over a year since our show, The Codec, has actually done an interview. Yong, like we mentioned, just moved. Ronan's pursuing some stuff with Twitch, and I joined the Police Academy, so we've all been really, really busy.
That's awesome.
Wow.
Yeah, it's
awesome. It's... Am I doing this right? Okay, later.
That's how we do it in America. No, everything is awesome. It's been real fun to kind of get the hype back for doing an interview. I forgot what that was like scheduling this, setting it up, and everything. So it's super fun. We have some stuff to talk about today. There's a new song out. We're going to talk about that in just a little bit. But first, I'd like to turn it over to Yong. He wants to kind of lead this interview off with what you guys have been up to. So Yong, if you want to take it away.
Yeah, it's been because it's been a while since our last interview. I figured we should all kind of sound off what we have been up to. I know Donna, you've obviously been pursuing your musical endeavors even further, and Stephanie, I've seen a couple projects you've been involved in, from indie films to various games. So talk to us a bit about what that's all about and what we should look forward to.
Right, who should start?
You go first.
Okay. After The Phantom Pain came out, I got quite some opportunities to work on films abroad, because at the time I was still in Japan. Now I'm back based in the Netherlands. And I got to be part of a Dutch film called Hostage X. And it's actually released in the United States and Japan. So
oh, really?
It's really exciting. Right. And also I've been in a Japanese feature film called Alessandra and the Fitter. Recently in a Dutch historical film called The Road of Repentance. So that's really cool to be able to start working on films. And also I'm voice acting for a few video games. Space Lords and Last Labyrinth are coming up this year.
Right.
And also an animation series from Chile. And I will start working on that later this year. So it's quite ahead, but
yeah,
it's been very exciting.
Yeah, there's a character named Suma that I saw on
that's
Twitter.
Right.
And it looks Space a Lords. Lot like you.
Right. Yeah. It's a character based on what I look like. So that's really exciting. But it's
awesome.
So different from Quiet. So it's cool to get a nice variety of characters.
Much more aggressive, much more battle ready. And then Last Labyrinth, you sang the song in the trailer, which sounds very beautiful,
right.
By the way.
I got to sing the theme song.
Yeah. And then you play, you voice act as the female character. Is that correct?
Yes. It's a little girl called Katia. Mm-hmm. And Last Labyrinth is a VR game. The player is actually bound to a wheelchair, and you're really restricted in your movements. And this girl, Katia, she's there to help you out. And by communicating with her, you can solve the puzzles and mysteries of of the world of Last Labyrinth.
Interesting. And are these games, as Space Lords is, that's been out for a while, and your character is a new addition, yes?
That's right, yeah.
And then Last Labyrinth, is that out yet, or?
No, it'll come out, it's scheduled to come out in October, November-ish. But yeah. As you know, like, game development, it can take its time.
For so sure.
And we'll have to wait a bit for an actual release date.
And for the films you're involved in, how do we check those out? Because I saw the trailer for the Dutch, is it a fantasy or is it like a medieval set, realistic?
It's a medieval setting, but it's an actual, it's an actual story that actually happened in the past.
Oh, it's a historical, I see.
Right. And it's now being taken to various film festivals. The production team just went to Cannes with it, so it'll be distributed amongst those festivals.
And then Hostage X, just, you said it came out in the U.S., and I think in the trailer I saw you with a sniper, which I thought was
right, I felt a little bit typecasted in that one, but it was still a lot of fun to work on.
Awesome. And Donna, tell us a bit about what you've been up to.
Well, actually, I have a sort of question for Stephanie. The historical drama, what year is it in?
It's, oh God, don't know the exact years, but I know.
Like, it's in the Second World War, or is it?
No. It's like medieval times. So it's, I believe it was around 1600.
So you're going to look a bit like, Game of Thrones-y.
Kind of, you could.
Costumes. I want to see that.
Yeah, I can show you a trailer.
The costumes look pretty good, actually. Yeah, yeah, the setting's really well created.
And no, she did a great job.
No, it's not a big typecast. Or maybe you've got a crossbow.
No, I don't feel typecast in that one. It's quite awesome. Different.
Oh, good. Sorry, Jan.
Oh, no, please.
Jump in and you'll see if I can sort of, make the interview by asking questions.
Oh, by any means, please. Please tell us a bit about your endeavors now, Donna. What have you been up to since the release of Phantom Pain?
Well, this morning I cut one of my cat's toenails. I did two loads of washing yesterday, and I'll be announcing that later. YouTube washing. What have I been doing? The Metal Gear concert's been fantastic. And
That little thing.
It was awesome to have Stephanie in Tokyo. We did two concerts in one day.
Really?
Yeah. It was awesome. Yeah.
That's crazy.
Did that put a strain, or was that on smooth sailing?
Yes, it did, but that's another story. There was the worst of it all, she had a bigger dress than me, massively. So until she turns around, she's got this massive train. It was awesome. It was really fun. We got to hang out with lots of fans in between the concerts.
Yeah.
And what else have I've been doing? I'll remember. Oh, I've got something coming up that I can't. It's going to be announced at E3. So.
Ooh, all right.
Something else, which I can't say, but it will be. I'm really excited.
So your name's going to pop up, and we're going to know it's Donna Burke?
You will, and I can't say any more than that, otherwise my NDA will be shot.
All right, something to look forward to. I like that.
Yeah.
What we're really excited about is working on the Metal Gear movie trailer.
Awesome.
The unofficial one.
Right.
Just heard the whole, damn it, I thought it was another Metal Gear movie. Lots of money has just been lost on bets. I'm sorry, internet. But anyway, we've been working on that since New York, and it's just been the biggest load of fun. And I hope the fans will just go nuts.
For sure.
I've heard the song, and they will go nuts.
It is great. It is. I've listen to the sneak peek that you sent us, and it sounds pretty. It's got this, like, a bit of a James Bond vibe to it, which I really like. And Can't wait for everyone else to see it. Now, speaking of the Metal Gear concert, I mean, obviously, you've been traveling around a lot from New York to L.A. and then back to Japan. So tell us a bit about what the process has been like setting that up. How long was that journey from saying, we want to make a concert to finally bringing it to the audience? And what was that experience like?
Well, I'm just the singer, so I have nothing to do with organizing mm-hmm. it. And fortunately, they can't put another singer in to replace Stephanie or me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
The robots haven't taken over our jobs yet, so that's awesome. You know, maybe if Stephanie or a Donna impersonator, no. And it's the challenge has been staying fit for me. I don't know, maybe also for Stephanie, because Sins of the Father is a bitch of a song to sing. And once that's in the first, once that's over, I'm like, screaming, yelling, you know, it's just, it's so physically demanding and emotionally demanding. So then Snake Eater is just like, I walk out, I'm like, hello!
So yeah. Just
walking. Yeah, yeah. And then Heaven's Divide is, I used to think it was difficult, but now it's like, eh.
Once you've done Sins of the Father, everything else just kind of doesn't compare, mm-hmm. right? Yeah. And Stephanie, you were brought into the process at some point. So when were you contacted? How did you come to participate in the concert down the line?
Well, I think I was contacted about 1 month before the Tokyo concert was held. So I was really, really excited and pleasantly surprised to be asked to perform Quiet's theme. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, it's just one song, but I still, it's just such a huge honor to be able to sing with the Tokyo Philharmonic Orchestra and
yeah,
to present that to the fans. It was just an amazing experience.
Yeah, for sure. Is there a chance you might be coming to the US and sing for us here?
I would love to, but I don't know.
I guess it's up to the folks arranging the whole thing to.
Yeah, I'm afraid it is. I would go.
In a heartbeat.
If they were asking me, I would have no hesitation of going, but we'll see.
Yeah. Well, at the very least, we got to hear you sing during the Game Awards way back when, which was
right,
really nice.
Right, that was a while back.
Yeah, yeah. So we got something at least.
You got it first.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I was less nervous this time. I do have to say I enjoyed it more at the Metal Gear in concert, I think, mm-hmm. because, you know, it was just like a concert full of Metal Gear love. So
yeah.
It felt so comforting to be surrounded by everyone who loves Metal Gear, you know?
Right. Yeah. When I attended the concert in New York, being surrounded by fans and everyone being there for the same purpose of loving the series, it really did add to the whole vibe, to the excitement,
yeah,
to the aura.
It's magical, I think.
It really is. And hearing the song live is very different from, you know, putting it on headphones or mm-hmm. blasting it on speakers. Just the way the sound carries through the theater. I mean, the memories flooding in. And I love the way you guys set it up so that it's, you know, timeline based. So you start from 3, you know, and go to Peace Walker and, you know, like Ground Zeroes, Phantom Pain, 1, 2. So it was going through the whole series again in my mind as the songs kept playing. Yeah, it was really cool. It was super cool.
Did you hear people sobbing?
And, oh, we lost Daly. You there?
Yeah, I'm back.
Oh, there we go. The video's back.
Okay.
Had a Skype crash.
But yeah, so just, kind of reliving that. It brought me certain emotions. So I'm sure a lot of people were sobbing or felt a lot of things. And based on the people that I talked to after the concert, yeah, everyone were like, man, I got the feels from that.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it looked fun. I didn't get to go. I did send one of our viewers from here, Gabriel, I think they've been working with Donna on some stuff.
coincidence. So this is all your doing. What's going to happen later?
Yeah, definitely. I didn't obviously expect that when we sent him down there, but he had helped me on a lot of different projects, creating the art and stuff for the codec. So I wanted to give him, you know, something back. And if I couldn't go, like, why shouldn't he? He lived right there. So yeah, we passed that off. I was super jealous because I saw the theater. That theater in New York was absolutely beautiful.
Yeah,
it was unbelievable. It was such a work of art.
Exactly. Yeah. I've never seen. I've been a couple of theaters here where I live in Jacksonville, and just nothing looks like that here. It was amazing looking. But that actually kind of leaded into one of the questions that I had, which was, Donna, you do, you know, not just Metal Gear music, you do a lot of different music, you do a lot of different stuff. Stephanie, obviously you do a ton of different things with, like, you know, the modeling, the acting, all of that. What was it like for you guys to see, like, these fans showing up dressed up as these characters, and how does that kind of compare to maybe some of the other avenues of work where you maybe don't see that so much?
Well, to me, I just feel so flattered whenever I see someone dressed up as Quiet.
Right.
The first time I met a Quiet cosplayer was at the Tokyo Game Show. And she was actually the same girl who showed up at the Metal Gear in concert in Tokyo. So
nice.
I still remembered her. And it's just so amazing to see how far their love to the series goes.
Right. And then for you, Donna, I mean, you have these people dressed up in, for this, you know, this video game, and they know every word of the song, you know, that you're singing. How does that, you know, translate for you as maybe opposed to some of the other stuff that you do?
As Stephanie said, it's just such an honor, and you feel such it's surreal. You feel grateful. You're making some people's year. You're touching them in a very, it's like a privilege.
Right.
And it's like an ambassador. So if you're an ambassador of a country, you behave differently, you treat people with more respect maybe than would, because you feel like you're on show, but that you've been given a great honor. And it needs to be a great honor of office. And, you know, they don't have to line up and ask for your signature. They don't have to, you know, they're choosing to do that. And we all know when we've met a famous person, you always feel like you're bothering them. You're hi. And so I know that feeling. And it's so I get to calm people down, say thank you, and treat them with the same kindness that I would want.
Yeah.
Random celebrity that I was, oh my God. It's not random. They've really come to see.
Mm-hmm.
It's really good.
I think that kind of plays into, you know, another aspect that I wanted to ask you both about. And that's, you know, when Metal Gear Solid 5 was releasing, obviously we had, you know, Yudana doing, you know, the iDroid and the song. We had
the cosplaying for that. You didn't ask about that.
I guarantee you there's an iDroid cosplay out there somewhere.
No way I came to the concert, not in Paris.
That's a big thing.
As an iDroid, just putting it out there.
It is. I understand that. And, you know, Stephanie, you played, you know, Quiet, who obviously is a pivotal character in the game. Did you guys have any idea at that point when you were recording for the song, Donna and you, Stephanie, when you were doing motion capture and stuff for Quiet, did you think you would be doing a concert, you know, years later? Or did you think maybe that was the end at the end of the game? Obviously, you've got fans and stuff like that carry over. But, you know, what was your idea of how this would live on? Did you have any idea you'd be doing stuff like this, what, 4 years down the road? Is that what you said it was now?
I hoped.
Yeah, but I couldn't imagine.
Yeah, no.
Right. It was hard to imagine. I was especially, I had no idea what people would think of Quiet, how she would be received as a character. So it's just a huge honor to see how well she was received and how people telling me like she's such a memorable character and how much the song meant to them. That's just beyond my expectations.
Very cool.
Yeah, I think for a lot of fans, I mean, given, I guess, the way the Metal Gear series concluded on the more corporate level, people weren't expecting much more. Exactly. So I think for me and for a lot of us to see this concert, it's a treat to be able to relive that, to be able to continue, you know, expressing our love for the series. And, you know, now with the Metal Gear movie coming up, so there's still things going on, which I love.
Exactly. And that's, so kind of, that's kind of what I was getting at, is I got an email months ago before the concerts were going on. And I know they were talked about like the year before, but I didn't know if anything would come of it. And I got an email saying, hey, the concert's taking place in New York. Do you want to go? And I wanted just to message Donna. I don't know why I didn't, just say, how did you make this happen? Like, tell me about how that concert came to be. Did they approach you? Was it something that you guys asked to do? Like, what was the idea behind going out and playing Metal Gear music?
Do you want to know the dorky corporate answer? So there's a company called Kyoto.
Half and half.
Okay. I'll give you the quick answer. Okay. At Tokyo Concert, there was a guy who's famous in Japan. He came out and played "Calling to the Night" on piano.
Oh, I love that song.
Great. Okay. So. But here's the thing. I said to Kyoto, who bought the rights from Konami to have the to do the concert, and Kyoto got Nicholas Buck to arrange all the music. So Kyoto had got special permission from Konami. So I said to Kyoto, we can't do another concert and it's just the same old. You know, can't I sing another song? And they're like, what song? This is in Paris. What song do you want to sing? Calling to the Night. Anyway, turns out, oh, Donna, you're not going to sing it. Some rando bloke, okay, he's super famous in Japan, but I don't know that. He's going to play your vocal song on the piano. And so I see the head of Kyoto. I'm like, what? And I was like, And they said, Donna, there wouldn't be a Metal Gear concert without that guy, because we are a concert, you know, we're the geniuses of concerts. We're on another concert with this guy, and he's just playing Metal Gear. And he said, rando famous piano bloke, said, you should do a concert of Metal Gear music.
Right.
They'd love it. And so when I saw him at the concert, I was like, oh, thank you. Without you, this would happen.
Right.
Wow, that is interesting.
Very grateful, because the guy made it happen. Spoke to people who know nothing about the music, said it's going to be a hit. They went to Konami, and Konami says, great. And that's how it happened, through a fan.
Wow, that's awesome. And I think that insight provides, you know, something that a lot of people were wondering is how the rights were given here. And that, I think that's great that it was, you know, given, you know, through fan access, which kind of plays into, you know, what's dropping today. You know, there was, I think what... Can we talk about that yet?
It's time.
Okay, it's time. So before we move into Yong's next set of questions, I want to share something with you guys that are watching live. Those of you who are watching this on YouTube, I'm sure Yong will have links in the description for that, as will I. But I want to drop a trailer in the chat that Donna shared with us. I'm going to let you guys look at that and listen to it while Yong asks his next set of questions. So Yong, if you want to go ahead and talk for a bit, I'm going to get this link sent to the people watching live and post it out on Twitter, and then I'll rejoin you guys.
Sure. So I don't know how much you guys can say if you're even involved, but I want to talk about Death Stranding for a little bit. First of all, what do you guys think? Have you seen some of the trailers? Do you think you understand what it's about? And having worked with Kojima in the past, you know, what do you make of it from what you've seen? What are your impressions?
Donna, do you want to go first?
I was actually going to say, this is all Stephanie's answer. I know nothing.
Okay.
I think it looks amazing. It looks unlike any game I've ever seen.
Yeah, for sure.
So, but I'm not involved, so.
Right.
I'm not sure. I do want to talk a bit about how I feel like, Yang, you put out a few videos speculating about my involvement.
Yeah.
And I think there has been a lot of it has been pretty confusing, the information out there. If a lot of people have been asking me if I was involved or not.
Mm-hmm.
And so actually, this was really early when the new Kojima Productions was just founded. And Kojima-san contacted me directly, and I speak Japanese, so he contacted me, mm-hmm. and he asked me if I was willing to play this character in Death Stranding, and he actually sent some really awesome looking concept art from Yoji Shinkawa with it, and a character description, and maybe I should show you guys, because otherwise it's just
sure.
empty words.
This is a scoop!
Right?
Kinda, I know.
Wow. Is this something would you prefer stay private, or would I be able to put this up on the video?
No, itself? I don't mind. I think I'm not under any NDA from Kojima Productions, so it was just sent to my phone, so I don't know if you can tell. It's hard to see.
Yeah.
This was the character.
Oh, Fragile.
Right. But obviously I am not cast as this character.
Yeah.
But anyway, for like the early days in development, for quite a while, I was under the impression that I was going to be involved in Death Stranding.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was silence for a long time. And so my management, after like about a year or so, because in the meantime, I wasn't going to bother Kojima-san, because mm-hmm. obviously he's been super busy setting up the new Kojima Productions. And
right.
So my management contacted Kojima Productions, and the answer we got back then was that casting had been finalized. So that's when I found out I wasn't involved in Death Stranding.
Oh. I see.
Very confusing. So I feel bad for, because I feel like you and the community have been very confused about it. And a lot of people have kind of been expecting me to be involved. But I ended up not being involved. And I think it's just that Kojima-san took a different route, a different mm-hmm. approach. He probably wanted to use Hollywood actors and sure. maybe reach a larger audience. So, you know, I totally understand. And they're great actors and so experienced. Yeah. So they'll do an amazing job. So I don't want to feel bitter about it. But sure. I just wanted to put that out there to clear that up.
Yeah, that's good to know, because I think a lot of fans, they saw, you know, Kojima putting on the hat, and then I think there was an event where they asked you some questions and you said, I can't comment on that, or, you know, you were kind of coy about it. So a lot of fans were thinking, oh, Stephanie's teasing something here. Mm-hmm. So I think this helps clarify maybe why some things may have seemed one way early on and then nothing. You know, we kind of started hearing nothing about that theory on the latter half of this development cycle. So that's very insightful, and I think fans will appreciate that. And thank you for the clarification. And
yeah, I just wanted to clarify that. So.
Yeah, and then I saw this one character in the trailer where they showed off Troy Baker's character, the man in the golden mask, Higgs, as he's now known. Mm-hmm. And there was this character that Norman was carrying, and she had like glasses, and from a side view, I thought it looked just like you, and I thought that's Stephanie.
I know a lot of people have been sending that image to me, and Yeah, even I thought she looked like me. And
yeah.
I was confused about the Dutch flag as well. So
right, right.
And then again, my management was like, wait, wait, aren't you in it after all? Isn't he? Like, so it was really confusing.
Huh.
But yeah.
Yeah, I know.
I don't know why that was, but.
Yeah, that is strange. I know. You know, with like David Hayter, for example, he had a similar kind of confusing process where he talked to the people and then was kind of radio silent, and then he learned that Kojima went a different route with Kiefer. So yeah, that's it's interesting. But you know, Kojima, he has his own way of working, and he has a vision, and I suppose. Yeah, he felt he had to go a certain route to realize that vision, which, you know, from a creative perspective, I can respect. But
yeah, of course.
Yeah, but for sure, that must have been very confusing to have gotten that call and then nothing.
Yeah, it was. But well,
yeah,
it is what it is.
Were you consciously trying to tease something for fans? Like, I know you took like a picture with Matt's poster at one point and people read into that.
Well, a little bit. Well, I'm also just a fan of Matt Mikkelsen, so
yeah.
I wasn't too conscious about it, but yeah, but still at that point I was thinking I was going to be involved, so mm-hmm.
If I may ask, there was a picture of you visiting Guerrilla Games at one point. Did that play into that at all? Because we know now that Kojima's collaborating with Guerrilla with mm-hmm. the Decima game engine, and a lot of people drew from that as well to speculate, is she in talks for something there? Was this an early part of the process of her casting? You know, what was that all about, if I may ask?
No, it might be a bit disappointing, but that was just because I have friends working at Guerrilla Studios, and
awesome.
It's the biggest studio in the Netherlands, so
yeah.
I was really just visiting.
Awesome, awesome. And you met some of the people there, the creative head at all? Herman?
Yeah, and I got a little sneak peek at their new games development, so
that was awesome. Too. Yeah, I think my theory is they're probably working on a sequel to Horizon. I don't know if that's been confirm, but I hope so, because that first game was truly one of the pinnacles of that year, in my opinion. And yeah, what those folks are doing, it's amazing. Obviously, Kojima was very impressed with their engine, with their technology.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking forward to seeing what they bring to the table.
But
cool. It's good to get that clarification from you. We don't have to barrage you anymore with questions,
okay.
Theories, and I'll stop making these videos that lead people to ask you questions that you're like, I can't, I don't know. So
that's all right.
I've got a question for you, Donna. I want to talk while this trailer is being sent out. Can you tell me about the process that went into creating this song? Because as I know, I mean, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but this song didn't exist when you guys did the concert.
Sorry, you're freezing. Sorry. Now you're back. So that's good. Can you start again?
Yes. Sorry. I think we're uploading, so maybe we're data capping here. What I was asking is, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but as of the concert in New York, the song that's being put out today didn't exist. Can you walk me
that's
through?
Exactly right. That's exactly right.
Can you walk me through how you created this song in such a short period of time?
To me, it seems like ages, because I get alerts on Google every day. Metal Gear Solid the movie. Metal Gear Solid the movie. And I think,
right.
What? Some other bastard's going to create a song from scratch and release it with a spoof video. I'm not the genius I thought I was. So what happened is I contacted Jordan Boat Roberts last year and asked him to be in Metal Gear Solid the movie, as you do on Instagram. And he texted me back saying, Donna, if there's a movie, you'll be in it. I love your work. So after I got my heart started again, I was like, holy, holy Batman. Oh, my God. Oh, but those Sony execs, I've got a few friends that work at Sony. They're fun. But, you know, they'll just shut poor Jordan down. They'll be like, who the hell's Donna Burke? We're getting Adele to sing the theme song. And so I was like, it's all very well for Jordan to flatter me like that. Anyway, I contacted him again and got said, asked him if he wanted some free tickets for the concerts. And then around that time, he puts out the poster for Oscar Isaac. And because Jordan is a fan like everyone else, and he's heard the rando comment of, yeah, I think I'd like to play Snake if Metal Gear Solid the movie, and straight away goes and gets a professional boss guy in Australia to make a movie poster, puts it out on the internet, like, just saying, I didn't say it, but if, this is what the movie, and I thought that was so fun, so like, getting ahead of the movie executives who are like, well, I don't think the numbers on Oscar Isaac are exactly right. We've got a young guy that we're... And he's just like jumping ahead, guerrilla marketing, getting this guy's image in front of everyone's mind. And I thought, that is so fun. He's playing by a fun rule. And so that I thought I got inspiration for that. I thought, if Jordan Vogt Roberts can make a spoof movie, I can make a spoof bloody trailer movie song and just give myself permission to, I'm actually writing the song, I'm singing the song, and this is what it's going to look like. And it's been so deliciously fun.
Wow.
Yeah, so, the song's super powerful, and I don't mean to cut you off there, but could you tell us where the kind of inspiration for these lyrics came from? Did you look at your like past work, or did you look maybe to what you thought the movie would be set like?
So when we were in, I got the idea when we were in New York, and I just asked Ray Azaga, this Canadian guy who was photographing, who's a freaking like library of Metal Gear, and he started saying, I think the movie's going to be set in about with Solid Snake. So here's me. Sorry, guys, I've never played the game. So I'm like looking up, who's Solid Snake on the World Wide Web?
Right.
As you do. And then I got lots of detail about his story. And then Nicholas, who's the arranger, so he's the guy that orchestrated all of the whole concerts, and he's played it. He's deeply embedded. He's seen the videos over and over. He's played the game. I thought he'd be perfect because I could have approached some of the other composers from the game that I've worked with and I'm on friendly terms with, but I thought it might be too much. Mm-hmm. And Nick is attached, but he's unattached. And he's the perfect, and he's conducted for Bond movies.
Wow.
And he's a master of movie theme songs, and that's what we're going for. We're going for a movie trailer. So I asked about it, and then I met with Gabriel from Quadic Cloud, and it all came together like, this is going to happen. So the lyrics came from Nick sending me the score, and just like when I did the demos for Sins of the Father, I just listen to it and I just write down anything, and maybe two-thirds of it is perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's all in the subconscious and it just comes out. And then there's a third, and then you start singing and think, I think these lyrics are trying too hard. And so it's quite an easy process for me.
Wow.
Very cool. Very cool. Sorry, Yon, go ahead, buddy.
Yeah. So you said you've Jordan himself contacted you saying.
No, he responded to me contacting him. Let's just.
Okay. He contacted you back.
Yeah.
And he responded. And so is there something, a partnership in the works there for the Metal Gear Solid movie? Can we expect to hear your powerful voice?
If you look at the trailer for Metal Gear Solid, the movie, the unofficial movie trailer, it says In a Parallel Universe Productions.
Mm-hmm. Right.
In a parallel universe, I will be singing the theme song because no Sony exec will be saying, it's Adele, bitch, get away. It'll be Jordan will be a god who has all power, all casting decisions will go through him, and he will deign it so. And So this is me, but copying him, getting ahead of the crowd, getting ahead of the people with real power, and getting the fans. This song is going to be so in their heads that they will...
It's smart. It is. It's very catchy.
It's fun. Yeah.
I think we'll see what happens, because I think Jordan's really leveraging the fact that there is a fandom surrounding this, that they really care, that there is a history behind these games, and that nothing short of pleasing the fans and making this for the fans will do this movie justice. So I think, you know, him bringing you in is really not that much of an unlikely prospect. Jordan's already brought in some of the actors of the Metal Gear Solid games to do some bits as part of his, you know, the marketing campaign, the guerrilla marketing, as you put it. He's bringing in everything, I think. He's really leveraging everything. And so, you know, Jordan, if you're watching this, you would be a fool to not have Donna sing for you, man. Come on.
Okay, this is an audition. I heard a lot of the A-lister things. So maybe there's a part in the movie where somebody brings in the water. Do that. I could nail that. Or someone has to do that. Right?
Audition reel right here. We got it.
You know, blows out a candle. Okay, I can't do that very well. But that's just a word.
You could be one of the soldiers, you know, or...
There you go.
Who drops a gun and then, you know, like, shoots the torch because
like in Star Wars, one of the stormtroopers was like Daniel Craig, for example. Like little things like that. You could...
Oh, I heard about that.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
That Ricky Gervais series, Extras? I totally want to be an extra when I... And I'm supposed to hand the cup, but then, you know, they always sort of come... You know,
right.
The extra.
Yeah. And fans can spot that, be like, hey, that's, I know that person.
Yeah. I know that clawed hand. Yes.
Now, go ahead.
We just want to have fun. We want people to feel like it's actually happened. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah.
I think it's also something nice just to give back to the fans. The way, like, the whole Metal Gear saga ended, I feel people will be so happy to, even if it's just a spoof, it'll keep the fan base alive.
Yeah, I think, like, Jordan himself is kind of, he's kind of doing fan art. When he did the whole Metal Gear 30th anniversary thing, he was being a fan and putting out fan art from all these amazing artists, and to see this song now. From the singer of Sins of the Father, which is, I think it's kind of an iconic song in the Metal Gear series. It's kind of become a meme. A lot of people reference that song often, in a lot of scenarios. So
have you heard that? I do a bit of a woho at the end of Hanging by a Thread. And it was really funny. When we were recording it, I was like, at the very end, and then, that didn't sound good. And I was like, oh, no, that sounds like a cat. No. Take after take. And then I was like, oh, I've got an idea. And then I was like,
that's
lovely.
Whoa-ho at the very end.
It was good.
Archie doesn't like it. He's running away.
Oh,
it's fine, mate.
Sure after that, we're gonna get a David Hayter cat account. We're gonna get a Donna Burke cat account.
Guys, please,
I'm calling for that. Somebody's gonna make that.
Definitely. I've got a question. What about the future of this kind of spoof project? Obviously, it's dropping today, so we need to give it some time to develop. But is there any chance that you continue to do more stuff like this, and maybe you two do a song together?
Yeah.
I have issues with Stephanie's fame, so I don't think my ego can stand it. Stephanie got was a good sport, and she came in, and she will be in the music video, which will be coming out next week. Paul Gabriel.
It's kind of like the behind the scenes video, right?
You're also in the music video. I haven't told you this, but
I don't know about that.
It starts with you because everyone knows Stephanie's a lovely person and she's really sweet and stuff. So when she has to play mean, it's really hilarious. So in the music video for Hanging by a Thread, it will start like a movie where Stephanie's sort of, can you just do it one more time, Donna, with a sort of like, because that's she did before. And then up then the trailer, then the whole, the song comes out. And at the very end, I come out of the booth with a, like, how did I do, Steph? And she's sort of on a phone. Yeah, it was great. So it's just really fun for the fans to see her being.
I see her face remembering this happening.
Yeah.
So you didn't know that that footage was going to be used for this?
Oh, yeah, I kind of forgot about all the little parts we shot.
That's fun.
Yeah, I think
that should be great.
Behind the scenes kind of clip on email, so maybe we'll take a look at that later. So yeah, with this trailer and this new song coming out, do you plan on maybe doing some more stuff like this?
I'd love to, and it's addictive, and let's just see what their reaction is, because I want to do another one. I don't know if Gabriel Morel wants to. He's probably having a nervous breakdown or recovery, poor guy. He's done a good job.
He's a hard worker. He works on the stuff that he's assigned day and night.
Well, see, we all have dreams, and I want to be helping Gabriel. Gabriel's helping my dream, and I'm hoping he gets his dream of working in a studio doing what he loves. So he's got a normal job now. But guys, contact him if you're looking for a great, talented, amazing, hardworking person.
Yeah, he's a great editor. He's done a lot of stuff for me. I run a fan-made Halo role-playing thing, and he makes trailers for us all the time. And like I said, he puts his heart into these things, and watching that trailer, I can tell he really spent a lot of time, kind of bringing your vision to life. Cause that's what he does for me, is we give him like a kind of road to follow, and he just sets out and his creative juices start flowing.
I barely told him anything. It's all him.
That's what I'm saying. You give him like an idea of what he needs to do, and he just goes
We copied Jordan Vogt Roberts' idea of using the image of Oscar Isaac and taking his movie action and putting him in a Metal Gear background. That's what Gabriel did, which makes it seem so like you're really watching. Your heart rate goes up. You actually feel like, oh my God, I really want to see this movie. So I showed my friend who's never seen anything to do with Metal Gear. She's, I want to see the movie. This movie is awesome.
And it's a like a compilation of different things. It's not even, you know, like that actual movie, which is amazing. That's great. Y'all, you want to take the next question?
Yeah. So E3's coming up, and Donna, you briefly hinted at something we can expect from you, but I just wanted to ask if you guys are excited for anything about E3 that you've heard about, what you might want to see, any games, any trailers, any rumblings you might want to tune into, or anything you might be able to tease at in regards to. I don't know if Stephanie, there's something at E3 we might be able to expect.
It's a bit too early for E3.
Sure. Okay, fair enough.
Hang on a second. Sorry, I'm interrupting you. I just realized what I can say is I'm really excited to see Final Fantasy Crystal Chronicles be re-released, which I'm in. And sorry, there's no NDA about that. I don't know why I'm carrying on. That's what I'm excited about. I'm hoping that's going to be announced that it's coming out. Because there's been coming out. So they don't tell me when it's coming out. So I'm hoping that's...
Okay. I know there's a Final Fantasy VII remake that they're showing off more of at E3, which is exciting because that was my personal first.
Right, that's what I'm excited about too.
Yeah, it looks really interesting. A bit nervous maybe because they're changing a lot of the gameplay mechanics. It's a lot more action-based, so we'll see how that works out. But I love the visuals. I love seeing these characters with modern graphical fidelity. So, and it harkens back to a lot of memories that I had growing up as a gamer.
For me too. I'm just not too happy about the probably episodic release.
Yeah.
I guess we'll have to deal with that.
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, for me, Final Fantasy VII, it's the whole package, and it has to come as a package. It has to be the full experience from beginning to end for them to end it at. To be continued. I don't know if that's the kind of thing you want for Final Fantasy VII, but you're a big Final Fantasy fan, I take it, because I know you did like a playthrough of 15 at one point in your Steph Plays channel. Yeah. Go ahead.
Oh, sorry. No. Yeah, I guess that's my biggest gaming fandom, at least.
Oh, yeah?
And
oh,
I'm also a big Star Wars fan, so.
Ooh, what do you think of that new trailer for Episode 9, if you've seen it?
Yeah, I've seen it. I'm very excited. I try not to have too many expectations.
Sure.
I like to go into the films as just as blank as possible. Mm-hmm. So I just watch the trailer one time, and then I try not to look into it too much.
I know.
Did we just switch from E3 to talking about films? Because I can talk about films.
Oh, for sure. Yeah. What's your take on stuff?
Well, I haven't seen the new Star Wars movie, but I am a huge fan. I thought you were talking about the game, so I was just sitting there like, I don't play that. Okay. Sorry. Back to you.
No, I mean, there is a new Star Wars game coming out as well, the Jedi Fallen Order, which also looks really good. But the 9th episode, there's that laugh at the end, which hints at potentially a certain character returning. So I'm wondering what that's all about.
He's not dead.
Oh, no, Palpatine. I think a lot of... It's not like... Oh, he's from the Emperor from the original movies. You know, the good that guy.
I can't remember him being dead. I'm still shocked that Tan.
Everything is proceeding as I foreseen.
He's one of my favorite characters, I think.
Yeah, and the actor is so into it. And he actually when they released the trailer, he showed up after the trailer finished playing, and he said, "Play it again," and then they played the trailer again. And that was the whole event. Yeah, right. That's how they concluded the event. So that seems like a pretty strong hint.
It's like it's going to be a busy year for video games and television. I think YouTube definitely will have a lot of opportunity there. We've got the Witcher series coming out. There's talk of a Star Wars, The Old Republic.
Cyberpunk?
For movies. There's a Netflix.
The movies. Witcher. Gotcha. Yeah.
Get The Witcher. There's a Star Wars one in the works. I don't know if it's a TV show or a movie as of yet, but it's The Old Republic, like the MMO that's out right now. You've got Metal Gear hopefully doing something this year. Halo. Sonic. Yeah.
Wow.
So there's a big resurgence. I don't think there's been this many video game movies since Mortal Kombat back in the 80s.
Do you guys think it's because Marvel's finished and now they're all desperate for the next big, they've already got all the fan base, so is that,
yeah. And I mean, Detective Pikachu just proved you can actually make a pretty good, adaptation from video game to film. So I'm excited for the future of these adaptations. Hopefully it's done for the right reasons, like with the Metal Gear Solid movie, which I feel like it's in good hands with Jordan. He seems to be in contact with Kojima a lot, which is kind of nice. They seem to be buddy-buddy, and he seems to have a strong vision. He seems to be a genuine fan, so we'll see how that works out. And hopefully Jordan will contact you two and get you involved somehow. I think he should bring everybody in and find a way to please the fans that way. Yeah.
As I said, here's my glass.
Yeah. All right. Well, as we get into the kind of tail end of the interview, we get some wrap up questions. I got one for each of you, Donna, if you want to take the answer first. This goes back a little bit into Metal Gear. You both have really taken a dive into like the Metal Gear scene. Donna, you're doing the concerts with Stephanie, and you're doing your own, fan kind of professional creation for this trailer. Stephanie, you've obviously I've done a lot showing up in cameos for different musical events and all the stuff that you've done with Quiet. What exactly about Metal Gear has stood out to you guys where you've put so much passion into doing this stuff? Was it the fan connection? Is it the story? Is it a combination of the both? Kind of tell me what's kind of drawn you back into working into this project.
The songs, the music's so powerful. It's so raw, it's so deep, it's so satisfying. It goes to very, it's amazingly complex for me as, and to connect, to be able to connect with the people who have experienced those characters in the game and who literally were that character. So it's not like they watched the movie passively, that they were Quiet, they were Snake, they were, so it's sort of way deeper than just being in a movie or I'm blabbering because it's really late and it's past my bedtime.
It's really early for me.
I'm sorry, y'all.
No, it's okay. It's okay.
It's amazing it. How many different time zones we are doing this.
I know.
But we really wanted to make it happen. So I think I definitely want to thank you, Donna and Stephanie and Yong for making it happen. I know us living all across the globe is definitely hard to do these dual interviews together.
I'm not a morning person, but this might just convert me right here.
Right.
Yeah.
That's good.
And so, Stephanie, so for you, what was kind of your draw to continue, you know, doing this music for Metal Gear? You know, I think a lot of people take a misconception with this because there are some actors and some singers that, you know, once they finish with a project, they're like, you know, it was good. Now it's time for me to do the next thing. And you guys have just continued to kind of breathe life into, you know, the Metal Gear universe since it's, you know, basically on hiatus until the foreseeable future. What was about it for you that kind of wanted you to kind of come back and keep doing it?
Well, like how Donna said, I think gaming is just such a deep medium, and that's what makes it so different. The whole just experiencing how deep it goes for the fans, and also just having these really loyal fans who keep supporting me throughout the years, and that's just it's one of the most beautiful things, and I never expected it.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how to sum it up.
Yeah, I know.
We're not at the level where we're like, I'm sorry, I'm shooting a movie, I don't have time to do a movie in concert, or, you know. It's like, it's hell yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm just so grateful for all the support people give you.
Definitely. And we see that. We see that here. I mean, you guys are here having an interview with us when you could be talking to, you know, the Washington Post or something. You know, you're here on Skype doing an interview with, you know, a successful YouTuber and an interviewer. So I think, you know, that really shows that you guys are reachable. What was that, Donna?
A policeman.
Gotta pass first. gotta pass first, but hopefully that'll be successful.
I suggest you watch Brooklyn 999 or whatever.
That is a great show.
I heard it's accurate.
Right.
Well, that's the last main question that I had. Yong, if you want to take up any other ones before we get into plug time.
I mean, I think I've asked everything that I've been curious about.
I've got one question for you guys, because what do you think about Death Stranding with all the movie stars and Lindsay Wagner and Mads and everyone? We know that Kojima-san wanted to use Kiefer because it was going to turn into a movie thing, and then it all went pear-shaped. So what's going on with the? Is it going to be a movie?
The Death Stranding.
Norman Reedus and...
I mean, I don't want to draw this out to another hour, talking about what... I mean, it's very much a video game, and Kojima is... He's always tried to fuse the cinema world with the interactive world. He's talked a lot about how he believes that in the not so distant future, they're basically going to be one and the same thing. And you know, in fact, it's funny. In Netflix, we recently saw the show. What is it called? Black Mirror. They released an interactive episode recently. So really? It's kind of he kind of has a point where we are seeing the two worlds fuse together. And I think it's him just perpetuating that by using Hollywood actors and making these games so cinematic. But at the same time, I think when it comes to playing the game, there's a lot of meta elements where he brings the player themselves into the game. With Metal Gear Solid 5, you know, he tried to essentially make the player a part of the legacy and make us another side of the big boss coin, if you will. Make us another side of that character, and it was his way of sending this message of you are a part of this too, thank you. It was kind of like that kind of message. And even in Metal Gear Solid 1, we saw how you could literally take the controller. There was at one point Snake was tortured, and he has this nano suit that can give him massages, and so the other person at the other end of the call said, hey, Snake, take the controller and put it on your shoulder. And then it would start vibrating. And Snake would be like, yeah. And, you know, or Psycho Mantis, you know, that boss battle. Mm. Very meta. And so I think, yeah, it's him trying to fuse the two worlds while bringing the audience into it. And now with Death Stranding, the theme is connections, which is trying to bring people together. We don't know what the gameplay system will be like, but he's trying to make a game where people, instead of shooting each other competitively, they have to work together to rebuild the world. That's the theme. Right. But how that manifests, we'll find out when the game launches. So that's kind of my brief thoughts on that. But in terms of character motivations and theories surrounding that, oh my God, it could go on forever. So I'll let you take
his,
it away.
That's his job. He could definitely do it forever. I tell you what. I'm waiting for him to figure out something where I've got to put the controller in like the freezer for an hour and it's got to be like a certain temperature for me to play the game.
Put it past him.
That's the kind of stuff that you know, we can expect from him. And I think regardless of how, you know, Death Stranding plays or feels, it's good for him to kind of get away from what he had been doing and do something different. You know, obviously, I'm a huge Metal Gear fan, and I hope there's something in the pipe for Metal Gear. Will it be the same? I don't think so. But regardless of that, putting like those feelings aside, I think Death Stranding is a perfect way for him to branch out, do something that he wants to do rather than something that he's being told to do. So that's where I'm on it right now. I've seen the trailers. They're super in depth. There's a lot going on there, and I think for me the biggest thing is, as long as he makes the game that he wants to make, you know, I'll play it and see how I feel about it then. I definitely think there's more that he hasn't said yet. He often does this, you know, with like. With Metal Gear Solid 5, you know, he did that, the same thing where, you know, the character swap and all of that. So this is yeah. his element, and he's definitely in it.
Hopefully, I don't know. I don't know if Stephanie, if you have you been in touch with Kojima since, or has that kind of fizzled out? Hopefully, you guys can reach out
really.
And.
Oh, yeah,
we'll tell him.
I'm sending him a few Snake Eater T-shirts. And I talk to Ludwig from time to time. We're friends.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah? I had a quick question about that. I've heard that they are actually releasing some Metal Gear vinyl up at San Diego Comic-Con. Do you have anything to do with that? Are you going to be there?
No, I do not. But I have heard talk of the next the concerts being recorded.
Oh, very cool. Awesome.
Very cool.
Yeah, so in the future, they haven't been done yet, so that's really exciting.
Okay. Yeah, this is specifically, I think it was from Rika Muranaka, who worked on some of the earlier Metal Gear games as a composer. She said something about there was going to be a release of some Metal Gear Solid tracks on vinyl, and I didn't know if maybe you had anything to do with that.
No, I'm not in contact with her.
Okay. All right, well, that pretty much wraps up the bulk of the interview. Thank you guys so much for answering all the questions. Let's get into plug time. Please, recent projects, social media stuff. Donna, if you want to tell us what you're working on, what do you want people to go watch right now, besides the trailer, which we're going to be pushing right now?
On Spotify and listen to Hanging by a Thread. It just dropped 3 hours ago.
Will you send us some links when this is over to the Spotify?
Spotify, and it's on iTunes.
And iTunes, perfect.
Wait, next week, the video with Stephanie being a little bit mean. Oh, yeah, the music video.
Okay. So we've got the song, the teaser trailer, a music video with Stephanie coming up. And then, do you have any more concert dates going on?
Not for Metal Gear. I've got a anime jazz gig. Oh, I've got a anime jazz gig in Tokyo next Saturday, the 14th. And then I'll be in New York at the Bowery Electric, performing with Jay Ensemble, Patrick Bartley. So it's my first time to be the jazz performance, and I'll be doing all my game and anime songs.
Cool.
So if you're in New York, come and see me. I'll be a lot more approachable. I won't have any people around me, so I bring your stuff, I'll do all the signings.
There we go. Okay, that's awesome. I think I think it would be interesting to have maybe you and Quentin Flynn do a song together. He's been doing a lot of music lately. I might see if he wants to get in contact with you. Maybe you guys can do another Metal Gear song. He plays Raiden in Metal Gear Solid 2 and 4.
And Revengeance.
And Revengeance.
Oh. I got to meet him at a convention in Kuwait. He's an amazing person.
I saw the pictures, yeah.
Super nice.
Very cool.
So more spoof stuff, more fan content, but of a really high quality. Like, it's getting a live studio orchestra is awesome.
Awesome. Thank you. What about you, Stephanie? What do you have going on right now that you want people to go check out? What's in the kind of future for you?
People will have to wait for a little while, but so my character Soma in Space Lords will be coming out somewhere in later this summer. So, but I guess keep an eye on my Twitter. I'll announce the release date once I know it. And the same goes for Last Labyrinth. I'm really excited. I learned a lot about VR, so I'm actually really excited about VR gaming right now.
Very cool.
I hope more people will be in the future. I hope it becomes more accessible. Mm-hmm. And when Last Labyrinth's release date will come out, I will make sure to put it on Twitter as well.
Is it a PSVR? PC?
It's multi-platform, so it'll be PSVR. But actually, it's also scheduled to come out on Oculus Quest.
Right, that's awesome.
Now too, so
Quest, I think. One? Yeah, yeah, mm-hmm. That's the one that's really going to push the boundaries.
For that one.
Yeah.
Ready for that?
I'm just realizing. Soma is spelled, I keep saying Soma and Houston, but it's actually Soma and Houston.
Right, yeah, Soma is another really unusual spelling and pronunciation, so.
Yeah, I think they based that off of your name a little bit with two O's. That's what it feels like anyway.
Right, okay, well, most popular social media links for you ladies, where we'd like to put the ones where fans can kind of contact you or express opinions up front. What is that going to be for you, Donna? Is that going to be Twitter?
Twitter for me, and Donna Burke Singer on Facebook.
Okay, Facebook and Twitter. And then for you, Stephanie?
For me, it's mostly Twitter and Instagram.
Okay. Twitter and Instagram. All right, so we'll make sure we have those two links forefront. For everybody watching this on the post. Yong, you got anything to say to wrap up, buddy?
Just, it's been a pleasure. We should do this more often.
I think so too.
Yeah, it's great to hang out. It's great to see you guys all again. It's great to see how far you guys keep pushing in your respective careers. And I don't know, I'm looking forward to seeing what's in store for all of you. It's great. It's just great to see all of this happen.
And I'm looking forward to seeing your first voice gig.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
I've already sent some emails out for you, man. I hope somebody contacts you. I know there's a lot of game developers making some awesome games right now that could use a talent like you. I know we did some stuff for D&D, for Mass Effect. That was super fun. I know you got.
Yeah, I got to work on a couple on one indie game called Lorelei, yep. And I play this character called Jimmy the Traveler, and it's so fun. This is what I need.
Cast again, Jimmy the Traveler, just because you moved from Delaware to yeah. Welcome to our world, typecast.
Thank you. I'm so excited. Yeah, this is my element, and I'm looking forward to improving and to growing as, I guess, an actor, if you will. We'll see what happens.
Do you still do your famous outro, Yum?
Oh, hell yeah.
All right, let's get it.
With that, I will see you guys next time. Yong out.
Thank you. Thank you, Steph.
Thank you.
Stephanie. Thank you, Donna. You guys have a great rest of your day. Thank you, Yong. Enjoy your day. We'll definitely be in contact on email and get links and all that stuff worked out. Guys, have a great rest of the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you guys for watching. Thanks. Bye.
Yeah, for sure.